Praise the Lord. Alleluia. Knowing that Christ indeed rose again from the grave and He is alive today. Therefore, our faith and our preaching is not in vain because He lives. Allow me to read 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 57. Thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us now stand together and we will be singing our opening hymn, a classical hymn to remind us that all glory belongs to God. It is hymn 13 entitled, To God Be the Glory. Amen. Good morning, brothers and sisters in the Lord. Can we greet our neighbor with a good morning? Today is the fourth Sunday of Easter, and we will be worshiping the Lord together as a church family. You may open your blue prayer book to page 1 for the greeting, or it is also flashing the screen. The Lord be with you. I was glad when they said to me, O come, let us sing to the Lord. God is spirit. Praise be to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Let us pray together the collect for purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us sing together, Gloria in Excelsis. The Lord be with you. Let us now pray this collect to remind us that we have a good shepherd who knows us by name. Together, O God, whose Son Jesus is the good shepherd of your people, grant that when we hear his voice, we may know him who calls us each by name and follow where he leads, who, with you and the Holy Spirit, lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated as we will be having the reading of the lessons.
The first reading is taken from Psalm 16, verses 5 to 11. Psalm 16, verses 5 to 11. Let us turn our pew Bibles to page 473. Verse 5. You, O Lord, are the portion of my inheritance and my cup. You maintain my lot. The lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. Yes, I have a good inheritance. I will bless the Lord who has given me counsel. My heart also instructs me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will rest in hope. For you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. The word of the Lord.
Our second reading is taken from Philippians chapter 3, verses 1 to 11. If you are using the Pew Bibles, you may turn to page 1018. 1018. Philippians chapter 3, verse 1. Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. For me to write the same things to you is not tedious, but for you it is safe. Beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the mutilation. For we are the circumcision who worship God in the Spirit, rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. Though I also might have confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so, as circumcised in the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of the Hebrews, concerning the law, a Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. But what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. But indeed I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness which is from the law, but that which through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us now rise for the reading of the gospel. The holy gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ is taken in John chapter 16, verses 19 to 24. Now Jesus knew that they desired to ask him, and he said to them, "Are you inquiring among yourselves about what I said? A little while, and you will not see me, and again a little while, and you will see me? Most assuredly, I say to you, that you will weep and lament, and the world will rejoice, and you will be sorrowful, but your sorrow will be turned into joy. A woman, when she is in labor, has sorrow because her hour has come. But as soon as she has given birth to the child, she no longer remembers the anguish for joy that a human being has been born into the world. Therefore, you now have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart will rejoice, and your joy no one will take away from you. And in that day, you will ask me nothing. Most assuredly, I say to you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. Until now, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be full." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated as we prepare our hearts to receive God's word through his servant, Pastor Jonathan Banzuela.
Well, brothers and sisters in the Lord, good morning. You know, I was given the responsibility to talk about joy, but we'll be focusing more on biblical joy. You know, as we have read Philippians chapter 3, I would like us to focus on the whole letter of Paul to the congregation of Philippi. You see, the theme of that particular letter is abounding joy. Well, probably you're thinking, well, probably Paul was happy, his circumstances were okay, everything was going smoothly. But on the contrary, when you read the context of the Philippian letter, you will find out that Apostle Paul was actually in prison. He was being prevented from doing ministry. He underwent trial, he was chained to soldiers, and not only that, there were people when he was in prison who were also trying to basically badmouth him, And these were things that he was aware of. And so you're thinking, how is it possible that a person will still write about joy, and when people read about the letter, they can be encouraged and inspired, even though they are undergoing such tremendous trials in their lives? So that's what we would like to focus on. That's why when we look at the description, biblical joy is different than what many people think. It's more than a simple emotion or a sense of overall cheerfulness. Joy in Christ is not dependent upon our situation or mood. It flows from our connection with the Lord and transcends our circumstances. Because of all He's done and continues to do, we can rejoice in Him no matter what happens. We just sang the hymn, "To God Be the Glory." When you were singing it, you were encouraged to adore God, right? Are you aware that Fanny Crosby, the composer of that song, was blind? And she has actually composed a lot of hymns, probably 1,000 or so. And many of those are in connection to how she was thankful and how she was basically giving glory to God. So that's what we call biblical joy. The circumstances may seem negative. There may be some trials and sufferings that you're enduring. But because the Lord is touching your mind, your heart, He's inspiring your soul, you're able to see things in a different light. Now, moving forward, let's look at Galatians 5, 22 to 23. You know, what's written here is, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law." Now, when we talk about the fruit of the Spirit, many people are intrigued. You have about 8 or 9 things written there, and the word is fruit because it's considered to be a cluster. Maybe you're saying, well, as a Christian, I already have the first 3, or probably about 4 of them. But you know why the Christian life is dynamic? It never stops as you are maturing, not only in the number of years as a Christian. It is very important that you also mature in your experience with God, and there's a development of our Christian character, that all of these fruit should be part of our lives. Meaning, the Lord expects us, as we partner with Him, with the movement of His Spirit in our lives, that we will bear these things, and these things will be developed in us. So, you see, we need to understand, how do we get this joy? How do we have the fruit of the Spirit? How does it manifest in my life? So, let's move forward and look at this. Now, in biblical terms, having joy means being happy about something good that has arrived or is coming. Like hope, it has a long-term view of life, emphasizing the good that will come. However, it has a component of great happiness, rejoicing at the good news. I presented the message just a few weeks ago. It was about Psalm 55. Now, it was a Psalm of David, and it was talking about fear. You know, when I was analyzing that particular psalm, I was really encouraged. Not that there was a problem in the life of David, but how David was presenting God in his situation. Many are saying that most likely the background was when one of his sons rebelled against him. Some of his former friends and advisors sided with his son. And so there was betrayal. There was real pain in his heart. Not only was there a challenge to his leadership, it came from people who were supposed to be very close to him. And here now is the problem. You cannot rely on your army. You're not sure if they're still loyal to you. You cannot really look at your family for help because in the first place, they're the ones you needed to protect and save because your enemies are planning to kill them. And you're thinking, everything that has been built and established in the course of my leadership, all of those things, they're threatening to tear it down. So a lot of things going on in his mind and in his heart. But then, when you look at what David is saying in that particular psalm, he's basically expressing, he's not saying that I read this and probably you can use this. It's not something that he's assuming. This is what he actually did. I cannot hold on to anything else. But I came to the Lord. I cried out to Him. He heard my voice, and He rescued me. You know, that is very important. Because, you know, most of the time, leaders, especially like David, he's a warrior king. A person like that, you do not simply expose to people your emotions. But here he was saying that he was crying. He was in distress. There was anguish. He was afraid. How many of you inabutan po ninyo yung song hits? Pakitaas lang yung mga. I mean, everybody knows what decade you're... pagka, you know, the song hits. Now, the idea is you have a new song. You hear it over the airwaves. You would like to know the lyrics. Because sometimes we just try to mimic what the singer is saying, but we're not really sure about the words. Correct? Then we're waiting for the song hits to be published. And then you will find the lyrics and the chords. And then, of course, you would like to sing it. And if you know how to play instruments, you play it, right? Now, remember, the Book of Psalms is a compilation of songs. Most of them were quite popular with the Jewish community. And here they will be reading about the song composed by the king, expressing all of these emotions, making himself vulnerable. But I'm thinking, David is practically saying, I don't care how you see me, but I want you to learn one very important lesson. Whenever you are experiencing troubles in your life, go to God. Trust in Him, and He will help you. He was hoping on the Lord. That's why when we talk about biblical joy, it's a joy of salvation. You're always thinking about, you're always recalling what the Lord has done for you. It's a joy that leads to proclamation. It is something that was so desperate. His situation, our situation, Paul's situation. And yet the Lord was able to turn things around, that even though He did not take away the troubles, the Lord was with them. He was with Paul. He was with David. And He can be with us as well. You know, many people are asking me, Pastor, can you pray that the Lord will take away the problems in my life? You know, as much as I would like to do that, maybe it won't be truthful. I would like to pray that myself for myself. I mean, you don't want troubles in life, right? Meron ba sa inyo, nagpa-pray kayo kay Reverend Justin? Reverend Justin, please pray for me. Dagdagan yung troubles sa life ko. Of course, wala. That's something we would like to push aside. But it's part of life's experience. It's part of the process that can be used by God. The promise is not to take away the trials and the troubles. But the promise of God is that I will never leave you nor forsake you. He will be there. Once you have experienced that, you will practically be like the personalities in the Bible who have seen the movement of God in their lives. They cannot help but proclaim it. They wanted to share it. That's why you have a lot of letters, even songs, that expresses gratitude towards God. That's the joy that leads to proclamation. Maybe you're praying, no? In a desperate moment, the Lord answered the prayer. Or sometimes you're not even praying. The Lord actually helped you in a situation. And you would like to really express thanksgiving. And you don't want to keep it to yourself. You would like to share it with others. This is what happened to these personalities. And it's a joy that leads to praise. You know, whenever there are Christian songs, right? You play it in your car, in your house, sometimes through your phone, and then it touches you. The testimony, most likely, of the person who composed it, how you can relate with the lyric, especially when it comes from the passages of Scripture, it affects you, and then it basically motivates you. Motivates you to do what? Adore God, and also look at things in a different way. So always remember, biblical joy is different. It can be proven by the next slide. Look at this. The first one, God is the one who fills us with joy. We cannot ourselves will it ourselves to experience joy. It comes from God alone. Now, it's like this. Smiling is the preoccupation of your facial muscles. Laughter may be in connection to some situation that you find funny. Biblical joy is different. It is connected with how the Lord is working in your life. So when you're identifying it, probably you remember how the Lord worked in your life in the past. You're able to observe how He's helping you in the present. And it can be connected to the future, your anticipation. That even though now there may be suffering, but you know one day you will be meeting up with Him, that causes an elation that is totally different from the other experiences you will be having in this life. That's the reason why the spiritual disciplines are important. You need to read your Bible to know more about God's Word, His promises, how He moves in your life. You have to discern it or identify it. You need to pray. You can converse with God. You know, there are times when we meet a person who is prayerful or who always reads the Bible and they give their perspective on situations. Sometimes you're thinking, parang iba to. Sometimes we find them weird, right? Have you ever experienced that? And then you're asking yourself, why does he think this way? Maybe the reason why that person sees things differently from you is probably in connection to the habit of practicing the spiritual disciplines. They're now wearing a different kind of lens, a lens that is connected to their experience and know-how of God and His truth. Ang tawag ni John Maxwell dun is intuition. Intuition is not kotob in that particular material. Intuition is familiarity. If you're familiar with God, if you're familiar with His truths, the way you think, the way you see things is in connection to that. Let me give you one example in particular. My father, many times over, as an administrator of PBS, you know my father, right? And my older brother, Jebo. And wrong promotion. Many times over, there will be some crisis in the school or there will be a project that needs to be done. You know, many people, whenever he says, I'm praying and the Lord is impressing on us this idea and this is what we need to do. You know, some people who lack faith are really, parang alarmed. How can we build such a building? We don't have money. One instance was the building of the academic building of PBS. It would cost about 30 million during that time. The money of PBS as an institution was 100,000 in the bank. Even the manager of the bank did not want to believe my mom when she asked the question, maybe you have another bank, maybe you would like to put the funds here. This is the only funds the school has. How can you build a building? By faith. No, the manager of the bank was staring blankly at my mom. How can you build a building 30 million worth or probably more? You only have 100,000 pesos here and you talk about faith. I mean, even I was doubting my dad. I'm thinking, well, you will be starting something you cannot finish. Mapapahiya ka. That's one thing I was thinking. And I was also thinking if, for example, you allow the contractor to continue on with the building project, assuring that there will be a payment eventually. Mapapahiya ka, makukulong ka pa. That's my thinking. Kaya nung natapos, napahiya ako. They see things differently. Maybe we have to realize it has something to do with a closer connection with the Lord. And this is also something that we need to develop. This should be the normal of a Christian. We need to be reading God's Word and see things the way God sees things. We need to commune with God so that we will be able to live a life of faith, trusting in Him. Maybe the world will think, oh, you're weird. That doesn't matter. What privilege we're given is that we will be able to experience these good things that the Lord provides so that you will have what we call biblical joy. Now, the second, it's a fruit of the Spirit. Meaning, we experience more joy when we spend time with God. We have to keep in mind that joy only comes from God, but when we spend more time with Him, we allow Him to fill us with it. Moving forward, we talked about Paul. We talked about David. You know Daniel, right? There are a lot of pressures in his life. But every time that when we read about, for example, the documentation of the life of Daniel in the Old Testament, we get inspired. How can such a person still have that firm conviction and declaration of his God, even though it was life-threatening? And it's as if everywhere he goes, whoever he interacts with, people identify this is a person favored by the Lord because his life is Spirit-filled. There is a difference in him that can be identified even by people who are looking at him. So that difference is because of the movement of God in his life. And that difference can also be the movement of God in our lives. But remember, the Lord's word is available. His promises are also for you and me. His Spirit is also for you and me. but it is a matter of allowing Him to have entry in your life and allowing Him to move in your life and also you trusting in Him. Now, the third, no one can take that joy from us. Now, look at what John stated in chapter 16, verse 22. In relation to that, given to us by God Himself, no one has the ability to rob us of our joy, no matter what circumstances we encounter. No one can take this away. You know the assurance given by Christ? No one can snatch you out from my Father's hand. And no one can snatch you out from my righteous right hand. And you're sealed with His Spirit. Why is that important? Why is the Lord and even those who were used by God to write the different parts of Scripture always re-emphasizing that point? Because people are prone to insecurity. We tend to fear, we tend to doubt, and sometimes we're thinking we're all alone, nobody cares, nobody's concerned. What about my future? What happens to me? That is a common experience, a common thought, and probably a common feeling for all of us. The Lord provides us the assurance. It's very important for us to note that the reason why we're always being reminded from God's Word of these truths, so that you will have that peace, and you will also experience that joy. Now, the fourth, joy rests in things from God such as salvation and righteousness. I was talking to this person. He had a very colorful background. Alam niyo yung ABS-CBN? Have you ever heard of that acronym? Not the TV station. Huh? It's basically Alak Babae Sugal. Pardon the term, but it's the C, Cabaret, Bar, and Nightclub. That was his past. So he was the one who told me, Pastor, that was my ABS-CBN. May GMA pa, hindi ko na maalala eh. Pero baka yun ang matandaan ninyo sa message. Ang message ni Pastor J, ABS-CBN. No, it's about joy. But I'm trying to tell you, this guy had a lot of troubles in his life, brought about by those habits. They were practices, habits, activities that he did. And because those things are consequential, they have a lot of negative effect in his life. He became so desperate one time, he wanted to end everything. It was a good thing that because of the Lord's grace, he had an encounter with a person who was talking to him constantly, gave him assurances from God's Word. It was different. And now he's a deacon of a church. He's saying, it is only God who can turn somebody coming from that background to a situation like this. Sabi niya, if you ask people, I'm a ruined being. I'm a morally ruined being. I don't have any possibilities of a good future. People will basically mislabel me. They always think of me as a loser, and I'm a person who is considered to be a bad person or a sinner. But with God, it's different. There was a change and a transformation that occurred. And He's always testifying to that. How can somebody like that can to turn into somebody like this? It's not saying he's perfect, but a person who can be used by God and there was a change. Paul himself was like that. You know his past, right? He was a religious zealot, but he was killing Christians. But then eventually, with the Lord touching his life, he became a missionary, a faithful servant to Christ. Only God can do that. And that's exactly what we have here. We have this joy because of the salvation and the righteousness provided by the Lord. It did not come from me. I am the ruined being. I am the one with the baggages and the problems. It is God who causes the transformation. Now, moving forward, let's look at joy as whole being. And let's look at five aspects. The first one, spiritual. When we talk about the spiritual, when I was reading Rick Warren's book, The Purpose-Driven Life, he mentioned there certain things that some existential philosophers were always dealing with. He said, man struggles with three things. The question of identity, who am I? Tama naman, right? The question of importance, do I matter? The question of impact, what would be my legacy? We don't know. And again, this causes us our insecurity. But you know what? The reason why in the Lord we can have joy is because when He touches your life, He gives it meaning and He gives it purpose. Look at Solomon. Solomon was a person, I find it quite odd, that the wisest person who has ever lived gave very good teachings inspired by the Lord, but many of those he did not follow at some point in his life. But then when he had the realization and the turning around, he was basically recommending you leave behind the pleasures of life. Why? Because when he was committing himself to the earthly things, what was happening was that he was not experiencing meaning, value, and purpose. That's why when you read his writings in Ecclesiastes, what was he declaring? Everything is vanity. All these things are meaningless. That was his life in pleasure. And so what did he recommend in the very last chapter? The whole duty of man is to fear God and obey His commands. You would like your internal being to truly have what the Lord says as meaningfulness. You need to have Christ in your life. And you need to cooperate with His plan and program in your life to truly have the fullness of that experience. Look at what Paul stated in Philippians 1:21. Again, Philippians, not the ideal background. But then he was stating to people, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Now, you have to understand, Philippi is part of Greek territory. And the Greeks, they have a different mindset. Number one, they're looking for the right reasons for living. Because they were taught by their philosophers, you have to find the right reason or the meaning for life. And many of them are looking at pleasure in the end, ruining themselves. That's why if you read the book of Acts, many of the early converts from the Gentiles were the Gentile women who got frustrated with the ruin of their families, their health, because the men keep on indulging in pleasures. And so they wanted a change, some improvement. Now, Paul was telling them, you want to truly know the meaning of life, its value? Surrender yourself to Christ, and he's stating through this line, for me, to live is Christ. Because back then, people were looking for tranquility, prosperity. Now, the other thing that the Greeks were looking for is a reason for dying, a good one. If you lived a life that is meaningful, and you die a valiant death, a noble death, then that would be a meaningful death. So hinahanap nila. Have you seen the movie 300? And you're thinking about these Spartans facing up to the Persians. It's as if they're happy that they're going to die in battle because they're going to die a noble death. Paul is saying, it's not like that for me. For me, I gave my life to Christ, and when I die a meaningful death. He was making a declaration and telling his audience, this is the central figure that you need in your life. You truly want to have meaning. You want to answer the question of identity, impact, and importance. You put Christ. You surrender yourself to Christ. And that interaction will elevate your existence. Even if you're going to pass away, it will be a meaningful death because you will be meeting up with Him. Imagine. Now, the second is in connection to the physical. Merong kasabihan sa Filipino, sakit ng kalingkingan, ramdam ng buong katawan. Now, look at what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 to 20. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own, you were bought at a price, therefore honor God with your bodies. The first thing that you will also find in Scripture is that the Lord is interested in your physical well-being as well. Now, we humans, we don't like to get hurt. On the other hand, we like pleasure. And some pleasures will lead to hurt. And in our pursuit of pleasure, we're even willing to hurt ourselves. Vices, for example. I was watching this YouTube video, and I find it disheartening that in many parts of Europe and the United States, they get addicted to this substance called fentanyl. Have you ever seen the videos? Imagine they're taking this drug, and many of them are already living like zombies, and they're doing this there on the road. And not only that, if they're not happy with that, they will take horse tranquilizer, mix the fentanyl there, inject it in their bodies, and then the parts of the bodies where it is injected will decay. Now, what am I driving at? people's mindset and their pursuit of pleasure, sometimes they do not think about their health anymore. You know, there was a drug pusher, no? Siya yung dealer. He was asked, your substances sometimes kill people. Well, yes. What happens? Well, if one of my clients die because of what I sell, I become more popular as a dealer. I'm thinking, what? Then he gave the answer. Because many of those who use it are thinking, the product I'm selling is more concentrated. They will line up and buy from me. Imagine, nakakamatay yung produkto mo, everybody lines up to him. And this is the mindset now. You try to watch the documentaries and you'll be thinking, am I really here? Parang, is this reality? And this is our current reality now. Sometimes, when we read the Bible, we have a sense of irritation. Why is the Lord forbidding me from doing this? It's talking to a person who loves yung mga drinking sprees. And there was a time we had a Bible study. Don't come and say, do not be drunk with wine that leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. It was so annoyed. Why doesn't God want this? Yung know, first miracle nga in the book of John was turning water into wine. You know, the justification of alcoholics. Sabi ko sa kanya, you know what? Yung alcohol sa wine in the New Testament is very light. It's 200 parts water to 1 part alcohol. It is to aid in drinking and to basically quench thirst. It's not for drunkenness. The barbarians, they drink so much of it to get drunk. So, nagre-reklamo siya. I was trying to explain to him. When the Lord is giving us these commands to prevent us from these compromises and these habits, vices, and addictions and activities, it is so that our physical bodies will not be ruined. Because if you get hurt health-wise or physically, the Lord understands your suffering. Yes, He is a God of healing. You can come to Him. He can help you at some point. But He also would allow the consequences. There's a reason why He's saying you should avoid these things. Second, in connection to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, Paul was talking to the Corinthians. Because it talks about prostitution, that a person's body, a Christian, should not interrelate with a prostitute. Why? Reputation. Your reputation, your self-respect is valuable to you. You cannot ruin that. And that's why the Lord is for the preservation of your testimony. So never ever think that the Lord is against you. Always think that the Lord's intention for you is good. His motivation is love. He wants you to be in a good condition and situation. That's why there are these reminders. Do not be annoyed. Appreciate it. He wants you to be joyful even in the physical condition. Now, the third, intellectual. When we talk about intellectual, we want understanding. You look at John 8:32, connecting it to John chapter 1, verses 1 to 18. Why did Jesus make Himself known as the Word that became flesh? Here He said, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Because, you know what? A lot of enslaving thoughts, customs, and even traditions prevent us from truly gaining freedom in life. I'm not saying that all customs and traditions are bad. I'm saying that many of them are also basically motivated by religious beliefs. Much worse, superstition. You try to look up the folkloristic definition of superstition, and what do you find? Fear of demons. I had a friend. He was issued a number, I think, SSS. Sabi niya, there are 4-4s in my number. So what? Pastor, pwede ba tong palitan? I don't know. But why would you change it? You already have a number. I mean, it took a while before you got that. It's the number 4. No offense intended. But this is what they explained to me. Because 4 pastor in Chinese is C. Oh, so bakit? Eh, it is the same sound as death. Eh, so tuwing may ganun, paano yung apelido ay C? Papalitan na rin natin. I mean, you cannot be, di ba, enslaved by all these things. That's why the Lord is saying, you have to be set free. And that's the good thing, that when you get exposed to God's truth, it clears up your mind, your thoughts. All the while I got enslaved by these thinking. One friend got so interested in horoscope, was actually enslaved by it. And one time even gave me a newspaper clipping. Ito yung sayo, Pisces ka. magugustuhan mo yung nakalagay dyan. Sabi ko, eh, di, ano ba yung nakalagay dyan? Basahin mo na lang. You look in the mirror and you will like what you will see. Eh, syempre, I see myself. Pero ang point ko, sabi ko, sometimes, you're too engrossed in that. May masamang mangyayari ngayon. I mean, eh, lagi naman may masamang mangyayari. Kaya lang, na-re-reinforce yung pag nadapa siya. Yun, tama yung sabi dito. Ay, sabi ko, look at yourself. You're always focusing on the not so good stuff in life. You cannot really move freely. There's no joy in your life because of that enslavement. Di pinakita ko sa kanya. Look at what's written in Deuteronomy 18, 9 to 13. When you enter the land the Lord your God is giving you, do not learn to imitate the detestable practices of the nations there. Let no one be found among you who interprets omens, engages in witchcraft, practices, di ba, yung sorcery, and even communicates with the dead. All who does these things will be detestable to the Lord. It's a preventive commandment. Why do you think the Lord is telling us not to engage in such occultic activities? Because it endangers you. That's why Christ is the truth. He's presenting us with spiritual realities, the ones that will help us, the ones that will really give us the freedom, the one that will empower our lives in connection to the Creator's design. So that is very important. Relational. You know, when we talk about relationships, this is a tricky one. Can I see a show of hands? How many of you are agreeing that relationships make you happy? Okay. Sampu lang kami. How many of you would say that relationships can give you pain or can make you sad? 20 na. Mas marami yung... The truth of the matter is it's basically like that. You need to relate with people because when you were created, you're a social being as designed by God. And relationships, you enjoy them. On the other hand, relationships can also frustrate you and can cause you pain. So how do I manage my relationships? Because parang ganito lang. Kunyari lang. I own this place and this is my house. May anay dito. Termites are eating this site. And then I'm thinking to myself, I have to do something about the termites. I consulted you. You're my friend. I have termites in my house. It's irritating me. Take care of it, Pastor. And then the following day, you discover I burned down my house. Anong iisipin ninyo kay Pastor Jay? Eh, medyo may diferensya si Pastor. Bakit? Sinunog yung bahay. You can basically just treat the termites. If there is a damage, then fix the damage, but not burn the whole house down. This is how we are with relationships. When we get frustrated, when there is agitation, when there are problems, we tend to burn our bridges and then burn everything. Tapos na to. Oh, ganun tayo. We are like that. In desperation, we make desperate moves. And we're hurtful. Kaya nga, instead of ruining relationships, because we need them as well, we need to understand, how do I deal with it? And look at what the Lord said in Mark 12, 30 to 31. Nang sabi dito, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The whole point of the matter is the Lord would like to process us first, the vertical relationship first. Connect with God. I'm not perfect. I will not be perfect here on earth, but I will be improved if I follow the Lord. Marami akong misgivings. I also have sins. I make mistakes. But with the improvement will be a better reason for me to have stable and healthy relationships. Do you agree? And so by us being processed by the Lord, tingnan ninyo yung order. And the second is this. This is the first. And the Lord emphasizes it. And the second is this. Love your neighbor as yourself. You can only improve in this connection, your connection with other people, if there is an improvement that has been done by God to you. Diba? Minsan ang sinasabi natin, dapat tanggapin ako kasi yung pelikula, maging sino ka man. Well, yes, there are certain things about your character that are stable. Introvert ka, extrovert ka, yan, mga stable na yan eh. But there are certain aspects that are malleable. It can be changed. How do you communicate? Are you respectful? How do you treat people? Are you considerate? I mean, those things can be adjusted. It's very important. Now, that's the reason why you would like to have the betterment, the health of the relationship. Very important, we connect with God. And then the last is called emotional. Most of the time, we attach happiness or joy with emotions. But you know, our emotions are basically what? It's volatile and it shifts, right? At one point, you're happy. At another point, you can be sad. Meron ganun talagang realities. But look at Matthew 11:28. Who do I run to when I don't feel too good? Because that would be a natural thing. Yung highs, gusto natin yan. That's natural. That's part of what you can also identify. But the lows are also there. That's something you can also identify. With the high points, parang hindi masyado problematic eh. Ano lang gagawin mo? That's a topic for Thanksgiving, right? The gratitude attitude. I'm recognizing, Lord, you're the source of this blessing, and I would like to use this to give glory to you. Okay yun. But the low points is the problem. What do? I don't feel too good. Di ba? And sometimes it becomes so serious. You don't see things in a good way anymore, even yourself. Di ba? Kaya apektado self-image natin, confidence natin, we doubt our future. Everything is bleak. That's what happens when we're at a low point of our lives. When I was talking to you about Psalm 55, connect na connect si David's experience natin. You know, if you read Psalm 55, which I challenge you or encourage you to do, the very last line, this is what David said. But for me, O Lord, I will trust in you. After stating a prayer, after writing that song in a form of expression to God, he made a declaration at the very end. I know that the only source for my betterment and my joy is you. And so here, look at what Christ is telling us. Come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That very passage alone is very helpful. Why? Most of the time when you don't feel good, you're thinking that other people don't like you. And sometimes they don't. There's this reality, the most likely you get rejected, you get pushed aside, and you're thinking nobody cares. And that's a dangerous place to be. But never forget, if humans will tend to reject us, the Lord, even at our lowest point, even stated in Scripture, while we were still sinners, that is our unloveliest moment, Christ died for us. Imagine that. And so what the Lord wants is for you to come to Him, and He will process you, and probably like Paul, like Daniel, like David, and the others, you too will have a testimony to share eventually, that because of the Lord, you can declare, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Or you can declare, as for me, I will trust in you, because you will understand firsthand how it is to be touched by the Lord and experience true joy, the biblical joy. So remember, biblical joy is different from how happiness or pleasure is defined by this world. Biblical joy is internal, and it's all related to our connection with Christ. God bless you all, and good morning.
Thank you, Pastor Jay, for reminding us that our true source of joy is God and having connection with Him. May that serves as a reviving message for us, something we can keep throughout the week and be blessed throughout the week. Let us now stand together as a response to what we have heard, the joy that we have been reminded to us. Let us now declare our faith using the Nicene Creed. Together, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, conceived by the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please kneel together as we have the prayers of the people. Father, we pray for Christians all over the world. Restore to each one of us the joy of our salvation, the joy that we have received when we first heard you. Reconcile churches who are divided. Uphold those who are being persecuted as of now. And sustain churches who are staying strong. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Father, just like the hymn that we have sang earlier, may we serve you and give you the glory that you deserve. Whether we are in school, at home, in our workplace, we pray that our life would have unspeakable joy as we love and serve you. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you. Father, we pray for our Prime Bishop, Brent, our Bishop-elect, James, Reverend Justin, our Rector, Deacon Eileen, Deacon Jeremiah, Pastor Jeff, and myself. Lord, fill us with your joy. Give us faith to serve you and spend intimate time with you. Keep us to be deeply in love with you and your scriptures. Lord, we pray that we would always be students of your word who faithfully practices and teaches the scripture. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. Father, we pray for our President, Marcos Jr., his cabinet members, and all government officials. May they keep their integrity in check. Sustain them by your grace to do the tasks expected of them, and may they do each of the tasks joyfully and excellently. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Father, help us to always choose you, to choose Jesus, especially when we are faced with important and critical decisions. Help us also to do good to all people at all times. Father, give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Lord, we pray for those who are physically ill, given our hot weather right now in the Philippines, those also who are mentally stressed, those who are emotionally overwhelmed, and those who are spiritually drained. Reveal to them, Lord, the great joy you have in store for them, the joy that surpasses any circumstances. And remind them of who you are. Father, have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. We praise you, Lord, for your saints who have entered into joy. Dear brothers and sisters in the Lord, now is the time to pray for our own needs and those of others. If you have taken notes of the prayer requests from the prayer wall, you may pray for them right now. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and to give us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever. Amen." Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, let us now confess our sins. 1 John 1, 8-9 says, "If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness." Let us now pray together the prayer of confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray you of your mercy. Forgive what we have been, amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Let us be reminded of the mercy of our Lord. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Let us now pray together the prayer of humble access. Most merciful Lord, we do not trust in our own merits to come to your table, but in your boundless grace. You have invited us to come to the table of the kingdom of heaven. Help us to partake of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we may evermore live in him and he in us. Amen. Let us now rise for the peace. Let us rejoice because our Lord says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give you. The peace of the Lord be always with you." Let us exchange the peace of the Lord to our neighbors, to those who are also worshiping at home. The peace of the Lord be with you. Please be seated. Let us now ready our offerings. Don't forget to write your attendance booklet found in the pews. Also, to those who are worshiping online, there's an attendance form there in the description in the YouTube channel. As we present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to the Lord, we'll be singing hymn 174 entitled, "I Need Thee Every Hour."
Let us all rise. Again, after the communion, after you have partaken of the communion, please be reminded to stay on your seats as our solemn response until the worship is ended. Let us now proceed with a great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed our duty and our joy always and everywhere to give you thanks, Almighty and Eternal Father, and on this day of our redemption to celebrate with joyful hearts the memory of your wonderful works. For by the mystery of his passion, Jesus Christ, your risen Son, has conquered the powers of death and hell and restored in men and women the image of your glory. He has placed them once more in paradise and opened to them the gate of life eternal. And so, in the joy of this Passover, earth and heaven resound with gladness. We join our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Let us now kneel and pray. Our holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us in your image. And when we fell into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us. He willingly stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for all mankind to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. On the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." And so together, we proclaim to the world the mystery of the faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And we offer you these gifts, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. But sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And so now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with much thanksgiving. Let us now kneel for the post-communion prayer. Let us sincerely say this prayer as our response to what we've received. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us now receive the blessing. Guan siyong te so su chut lang igwa e piang an po siu din e sim huay idiam. Ho din hiao tit kiang ai siyong te kap ye siyang kia lan e kiu zu ya so kitok. Ko guan chuan diang e siyong te siyang pe siyang kia siyang diang su hok ho din tit kao yang wan and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us be seated. Praise God for the communion. For what Christ has done, let's now hear the announcements.
Just a few announcements. The first one, for those who will be attending the Marriage Keepers Fellowship, it will be right after our worship service, and it will be in the music room, which is fourth floor of the Faithfulness Building here at the back. So for those who are attending the MK Fellowship, it's in the fourth floor. Look for the music room in the Faithfulness Building. For our second announcement, we'll be calling on Sister Kimberly to do the JYSC announcement.
Good morning, SSP family. I am Kimberly Ko, from Head of the Secretariat Committee for our upcoming Joint Youth Summer Conference. I have good news regarding our upcoming JYSC entitled Project Match, which will be held at CCT Tagaytay from June 18 to 22. The deadline for registration has been extended to May 5. If you're still on the fence, considering whether to join our camp or not, don't hesitate any longer as there are only 23 slots remaining. If you want to have one of the most fruitful, fun, and fulfilling 5 days worth of praising God and learning His Word, then what are you waiting for? Register now at the back after our service or enjoy and in Young People's Fellowship. Once again, the deadline for our JYSC registration is extended until May 5, and there are only 23 slots remaining. This is open to grade 6 to 12 students and college students. Thank you and God bless.
Thank you, Sister Kimberly. So what are you waiting for? We could sign up for the JYSC at the back after the service. You may also see our prayer wall. It is still ongoing. If you like to pray for the prayer request posted there, please do so. Take a picture of it or copy it somewhere. Okay. So we praise God for our worship service to Him this morning. We pray that it is acceptable and a fragrance offering to our Lord. Right now, we'll be singing our closing hymn. Let us now rise together. We will be singing hymn 120, entitled, Oh Happy Day. Thank you.
Go in peace and joy to love and serve the Lord.